very much. If I have your attention, please. Sorry for that late. Gone past 6. Just been reminded by somebody. Okay, you've got the agenda in front of you, yeah? It's going to welcome you as well. Apologies for absence. I've got Councillor Chris Spriggs.
Apologies for Cathy Hobson and being deputised by Bruce Berry.
Members, any members declare any interest in the party with it? Okay, next. Minutes, can we approve the accuracy of the minutes of the last meeting on the 28th of November?
Can I just raise an issue?
Yeah.
Just something that that you're not recording under apologies. Well, the under 24 apologies for absence, Jean Stapleton, one of them, to meet Mrs. Turner, which is in place here, in Cllr Pat Hackett's absence. So, in the week of deputies, Steve Barrett and Pat Hackett, apologies to Sir Roy Sullivan and G. Wood.
That's noted. Thank you. The accuracy in the minutes of the last meeting. Okay, number four, item four. Impact of car park charge and luxury parks update. Steve Hackett, a progress report on that.
Thanks, Steve. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I think most members are aware of that. I'm Steve Atkins, the Parking Services Manager at Wirral Council. I'd just like to start by giving a very brief background to the report. So, at the Cabinet meeting of the 19th of June 2017, it was resolved that Cabinet approves the introduction of car parking charges in country parks and approves the introduction of a household membership scheme for the use of country parks at a cost of £50 per annum. This decision was called in and a special meeting of the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee which was held on Tuesday the 18th of July 2017. Following the debate, including listening to petitioners' comments, it was resolved that the committee opposed the decision of the Cabinet taking on the 19th of June 2017 in respect of the car parking charges. Officers of the Council then followed the Council's tendering process to procure the new paint display equipment and an order was placed with the supplier in mid-September. The machines at Country Park location were then installed in January 2018 and charging started on or around the 23rd of January 2018. The report provides an update on the income generated from the parking charges at the Country Parks. The report recommends that the contents are noted, that charging for parking at the country parks remains, and that the impact of the charges on traffic management issues is continually monitored. The key points to note from the report and the supplementary information is that the number of transactions is 146,500 and the net income is around 156,000, which is in line with the predictions. As predicted, there has been some displaced parking in certain locations, but this displaced parking is not considered to have had a detrimental impact on highway safety or traffic flows. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Steve. Members, questions? Councillor Blakeley.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Steve. Just something to put straight first. You're saying that there's 176,000 is the outcome. But that is from January to December, I'm sure, not financial year. Is that correct? Or is it the financial year that you make investments? Because the financial year doesn't end until the 25th of March.
So when I first wrote the report, I did it from when the charges started at around the 22nd, 23rd of January up until the end. 8th of December. Since then, I've submitted supplementary information, which includes up to, I think I did it up to the 18th of January, so there's a little bit more of income, around about £8,000 worth of income from January this year. So it's almost a full year period from January to January, but it's not a financial year period.
As you're well aware, the services are totally opposed to putting the parking charges on in country parks. We should be encouraging people to attend country parks. You know, one of the pledges is about health and well-being. These country parks not only help people with physical health, they help people with mental health. And yet we continue to put barriers in the way of people attending our country parks. And in doing that, we see from the reports that we endanger other road users because of parking issues, and we have a negative impact on the businesses, we operate businesses within the country parks. So all in all, I think the council is doing its very best to discourage people from using country parks, perhaps in the long run it wants to build on them, who knows, but for some reason it certainly wants to stop people using the country parks, it wants to close the businesses, and it wants to create more traffic hazards. That might be incredible.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I note from the report on page 19 that by far the largest amount of revenue seems to be embraced from Wirral Country Park, which I'm assuming is the Thurston one, and yet there's any comment from the users or the operators of businesses that is conspicuous by its absence. I wonder if Steve can tell us whether he has been contacted by anybody, because it's in my ward, and I've certainly been contacted by many, many people over the last few months asking for this situation to be reversed for the very reason that I won't repeat that Chris Blakeley has already said. So the quick question is, have you had any response from the businesses that were operating at Thurston or from anybody else that could contribute to this meeting? Because that park has contributed more money than anybody else. Thank you, Chair.
Through you, Chair. Yeah, Wirral Country Park is Thurston Country Park, that's correct in that. The only communication I've had from them is by the park rangers or the owner of the coffee shop, which I think changed ownership all the way through the years. So that's the only correspondence and communication that I've had, but it's not been in regards to the negative impact of the charges within the country park there.
Councillor Mitchell.
Thank you, Chair. I'd just like to highlight to everybody 3.7, it should relate to even more taxes and it's the one thing that did come out from when we had the calling in relation to this was the questions that were asked and the answers in relation to contact with businesses. And in the report of budget proposals and scrutiny committee in January 17, questions asked around the planning and public consultation. Members believed in order for them to be able to discuss resolutions and response to questions, a clear communication strategy was required on this issue. Members were informed that a statutory consultation would be conducted prior to the implementation of these proposals. The reason I've led that out is because I will highlight again that Eastern Country Park and the businesses that were affected there, not one of them were consulted at all by anybody from this authority. And I believe the proposals of the Cllr in relation to those businesses, you can see in 3.7 and 3.10, the detrimental effect it's had on those businesses. In fact, one of them said they might be closing over the winter season because the falling patronage of the year. Now the argument that was given for not putting car parking charges in Hoyle, Cascadian, Brighton, Bedrington, Eswell, etc., etc., was because of the effect on businesses. Now this is a detrimental effect on businesses in this particular way. And I've actually got a recommendation to move at the end of everybody's finished discussing this because I do believe that's a detrimental effect in that particular area.
Okay.
you, Councillor Mitchell. Councillor Tom Usher.
Thanks, Chair. I'm new to this committee, but I've been following the car parking charges and the issue quite closely. You know, I think that they're a fairly standard way in which council could use revenue, and what would be interesting to look at as a committee would be the figures of visitor numbers over the next few years or so, because they haven't been moving in place for a year, and to see, you know, whether these figures increase or decrease, and then we can have a sort of discussion around how the car parking charges affect whether people use parks or not. But I think, you know, it's also important that, you know, as a council, we don't act as if our policies, you know, are made in isolation. We're in a very difficult position financially, and the country parks do need a certain level of upkeep, so we do need to generate revenue in order to actually maintain the parks so that people can use them. Again, just a point on not acting as if our policies are sort of in isolation. We do need to consider how residents and businesses are affected. And I'm wondering whether we've been offering any sort of business support to the businesses who have claimed to be impacted by car parking charges, and what kind of support we're looking to give them, as well as residents who've had effects such as difficulty parking in their areas. Because I know that, you know, there are a number of areas on Wirral that have had car parking charges for a very long time, and businesses still, you know, exist and thrive in those areas, and they, you know, put forward schemes such as, you know, getting a certain amount of money off your bill if you're in possession of car parking charge or a car parking ticket, for example. So I'm just wondering if we've offered any kind of support to the businesses who we've talked to in consultation around the country car parking charges. Thanks.
Steve, can you just answer that question on incentives in terms of the ticket? Yeah, and in terms of what Tom was saying, because it's one thing.
In terms of the sort of visitor numbers, the statistics we had were, and was previously reported, was from around 2012, that they were then used to model the assessments. As indicated in the report, we've had about 146,500 transactions. So the transactions through the name display machines or the folks at our cafe, etc. That's maybe car sharing, etc. So it's not actual visitor numbers to the parks. If members wish to support them, I'm hoping for that we actually do some visitor number surveys and things like that, then obviously that could be arranged. We haven't carried out any formal assessments on the impact for businesses, but again, that's something that could be looked at in the future. There are many different mechanisms for incentivising parking, etc. As a business district association, will give a discount from a double issue penny display ticket within the shops within the Scarlet Runner Roll scheme within that. It is something through an app-based Thomas Park statistic that you can give discounts or incentives to that. We have to be careful how we look at that, how we do that, incentivising, and to be fairly consistent across all areas and not just certain parts of the world to all businesses. But there are ways and means of doing such things like that.
Thank you. Councillor Jo Bird.
Thanks very much, and thank you to the studio report, much appreciated. It's disappointing we don't have the data for the visitor movement. What I'm hearing on the doorstep anecdotally is charging for car parking is a major barrier for people going there, and there's a lot of health disadvantages to disclosing that. Going for a walk in the woods, or at least somewhere, is really good for one's mental and physical health. It does actually balance somewhat with air quality. and very bad air quality in South Wirral and Birkenhead. And public transport is a major answer to that, the diversity and variety of transport to get to our country park. So the footpaths, the coastal footpaths, cycling routes, there's now alley buses to Eastern, which is great, thanks to the Lightning campaign. And I really could add to that a ferry from Liverpool or across the rural coast like Liverpool to Eastern. I think the fundamental issue around the car parking charges is fairness. Some parts of the Wirral don't have car parking charges like New Brighton. There's the Croft in my ward of Bromley, which has ample free parking. Why are some of the parts charged for and some parts not? That's a fundamental fairness issue and a practical issue of how much money does it raise. You know, Eastern raised £23,000 in a year. Displacement is a big issue. People park it if they know the area where they park free rather than paying the charges. So it doesn't seem very much.
The headline figure that actually showing in the income due to the parking charges obviously looks impressive. However, what we need to look at without a doubt is the correlation which Councillor she's just suggested between visitor numbers declining and actually imposing parking charges. But I think there's another fundamental one, the correlation that definitely needs to be looked at. So we're saying 150 grand per annum, which is coming into the council coffers, which is, as you said, very necessary in the current circumstances. However, if some of these businesses are given a headline figure of 20% reduction in income, I think there's a very severe possibility that many of those businesses are going to cease trading. Now, what are we actually going to lose in these areas in business rates? And that's the correlation that we need to be looking at. So, like saying we're generating 150 grand, but if we're pulling off businesses who are going to spend money in the region, if we're actually pulling businesses who pay into the council coffers also through business rates out of business, then what's the real impact due to these parking charges? And that's something that I think needs to be taken away as an action.
Any other comments?
If I may, Chairman, it's just an answer to the question posed by Councillor Baird in relation to any highway to parking, revenue must be spent on highways outside of that, the local authority can spend a bit of money. And I think that's one of the fundamental questions. When it went out originally to consultation, that they named lots of highways where they knew the revenue would go straight back into highways, but wouldn't be able to be used to subsidise the budget of the council. So Tony's just raised a very, very important point. If we're looking at an area where you've got 5 or 6 businesses which are really struggling, the major effect on that is not really just the businesses, the jobs, but the visitor economy as well. And I think that's the point that I'm trying to get across more than anything. I'll speak up as much as I like about the board of representatives. It's great. I say that because it was myself and your predecessor, the state government chair at the time, actually came to Eastern as a discussion this week with the residents, the businesses, and the affected sector. And nobody else is going to say a new word on the presentation.
Okay, David, you want
to? Okay, and it's really. Committee notes the findings reported in section 3.7 and 3.8 relates to firm opinions expressed at the meeting between local business owners, board members, and Councillor Sullivan, the then chair of this committee, on the 11th of July 2018. Committee now also appreciates the diversion of parking in all locations in the vicinity of the country park has continued with the impact on Ferry Road, increased uses of Blakeley and Pavilion car park, locations such as Tor Drive, T-Bay Road, within the car park of M&B, which is a major business on the A14. Committee plus Riverwood Road. Committee must understand the adverse effect that this has had on local businesses who had so much to do with their economy. Committee recommends to Cabinet that the impact on the local business communities should now be given the same consideration as other areas where transfer charges were dropped due to their impact. And so we're
thank you, Councillor Mitchell. Councillor Usher.
David, I think that that's a fairly fine motion, aside from perhaps the last paragraph. And as we've discussed, you know, I think everyone's interested in seeing the sort of long-term effects of these car parking charges and ensuring that they don't impact negatively on residents' health, residents' well-being, and the sort of performance of local businesses in the area. But it seems like we haven't actually, it seems like there hasn't really been a holistic approach to this policy, and that we haven't necessarily given much support to businesses. We haven't seen exactly how we could alleviate some of the issues that were caused by the country parks charging. By going to the highways department and sort of looking at how we can actually implement around the roads affected, you know, something like adding a residence parking or something that will alleviate the kind of the parking that's now moved onto sort of residence streets and stuff like that. And I think we, as far as I'm aware, we haven't approached sort of some travel or we haven't sort of asked that, you know, any kind of plan for public transport to these country parks be looked at either. So I'm perfectly fine with the motion, but I was hoping to propose an amendment to the motion. Just hang on.
That's how it's said.
We need to speak entirely new motion.
Can I
just come back and answer the question if you just moment?
Let's just move the recommendation, because the recommendation is going to be moved anyway. Yeah.
I'll have an amendment to the recommendation, or an amendment to Tom Usher's amendment to Dave Mitchell's motion, whichever way it is. I think Mr. McCord's quite correct. Dave needs a second before we can move forward.
David, would it be perhaps if I read out the my part of the
I'll listen to what you've got to say, Tom.
And if we could replace the last sort of paragraph with what I have to say, then maybe we could
listen to what you say together. That'd be good.
So if we remove, committee recommends to Cabinet that the impact on local businesses, the local business community should now be given the same consideration as other areas where plans for charges were dropped due to their impact, and replace it with, committee notes that the considerations of residents and local businesses and their contribution to the local economy should be valued and given serious consideration in any decision made by Council. The committee notes that the country car parking charges have operated for a year and commits to monitoring the effects of country car parking charges on visitor levels in the coming months. Committee recommends that the Cabinet looks at ways in which the effects of the country car parking charges can be minimised for local businesses and residents. We ask that any business support be given in order to assist with the transition, and that the Highways Department look at implementing measures to ease the effects on the roads around country parks. We also ask that the extension of public transport to country parks be looked at.
If I may, Chair, someone to accept.
Yeah, you went to accept that?
I'm just going to respond to it first before I say the last
item.
There's two particular issues in relation to what you just said. One is in relation to talking to busy travel and getting public transport into these areas. I've been fighting for years because he took it away from me. Your colleague Joe can know more about that than maybe he can tell you the reasons behind it. The other side of that is the point is that I'm asking for due diligence in that they've already looked, the cabinet has already looked at this particular issue. And in other areas, they've taken the view that businesses have been affected and they've refused to put parking charges in. All I'm asking for is a level playing field, and it be even for everybody. And that's why specifically in this area, the area I represent, it is very detrimental. We don't know whether the other businesses have been affected by the effect of public car parking charges. We'd love to know the effect of what's happened to the lady that had the cafe in her park. My colleague was in tears when we had the air for the COVID because she knew how detrimental the charges would be on her enterprise. I'm only interested in my walk, but I'm interested in that people get the right results at the end of the day. So I've listened carefully to what you've had to say, but I believe mine is not well considered.
Councillor Mitchell. Councillor Mitchell.
Yes,
just obviously not yet, because but in that case, could I have please recorded that I'd move this in the minutes? I'll pass it down to the
So Councillor Usher now, since Councillor Usher can't get a second there. You're moving that motion.
Yeah, well, all of us, I just wanted to register an interest as Professor members of Mersey Travel outside because Mersey Travel is in that
mention. You've got a second.
Yeah.
I'll just read it out once more, Chair. I'd like to move this particular motion. Committee notes that the considerations of residents and local businesses and their contribution to the local economy should be valued and given serious consideration in any decision. The committee notes that the country car parking charges have operated for a year and commits to monitoring the effect of country car parking charges on visitor levels in the coming months. The committee recommends that the Cabinet looks at ways in which the effect of country car parking charges can be minimised for local businesses and residents. We ask that any business support be given in order to assist with the transition and that the Highways Department look at implementing measures to ease the effects on the roads around country parks. We also ask that the extension of public transport to country parks be looked at.
Thank you. We've got a second then. That's the same as a second.
Thanks, Chair. So this is an amendment to Councillor Bush's recommendation. Business Committee notes that the introduction of parking charges at our country parks has had a negative impact on visitors, which has had a knock-on effect on businesses that operate in our parks. Business Committee notes the loss of income if charges were stopped could be recovered by ceasing the production and distribution of its newspaper, The Wirral View. Therefore, Business Committee requests Cabinet to scrap parking charges at Wirral Country Parks and make up the shortfall in revenue by ceasing production and distribution of Wirral View to ensure our community country parks can be accessed by all free of charge.
Second.
I do apologise to members, but just whether it would affect my voting in relation to being a member of Mersey Travel.
No,
thank you, that was all, nothing more. Thank you.
Okay, we'll go with the motion first by Councillor Blakeley. Sorry, amendment first by Councillor Blakeley. All those.
question, Conservative votes are recorded. Thank you.
We've got the motion from Councillor Tom Usher. All those in favour? All those against? That motion is carried. Okay, thank you everybody for your okay, number five, investment and change board and review commercial ideas panel. Do you introduce this chair and move the director of finance and investment
in terms of business cases that are produced, not templates,
what the directorates were sort of operating in their own, using their own templates, they had their own sort of forms, and there wasn't, you know, they weren't sort of being completed comprehensively, so didn't have one clear template going forward that everybody was completing. And there was no real sort of overall account of the council's exposure to risk. And this was, as I mentioned before, because projects were being undertaken on an individual basis without them being looked at in the whole, and sort of like the long and the medium term plan of the council, couldn't really appreciate the whole exposure to risk. Things have moved on in terms of investment and change for the council over the last 12 months, so we are doing a lot more than we were previously. So in terms of what had happened previously, it probably fit the purpose of what happened in the past sort of 2 or 3 years previous, but as I say, because we've moved on now and the council is changing quite rapidly, there was this need for a different sort of whole governance process to make sure that we could manage and coordinate this properly. So some of the items, just to give you an example of the things that we discussed at the Investment and Change Board, some of these are the projects that have come forward already. The Birkenhead Commercial District, you'll know, went to Cabinet in November. This has come back to Investment and Change Board quite a few times, so it kind of come as a sort of strategic outline business case, and it came out outline business case, full business case, and it was kicked about a couple of times really. You know, we talked about it, we had presentations on it, and each time the business case was refined to ensure that it was in a proper format, had all the content to be able to go through to Cabinet, all the information for them to make a decision. The Wirral Waters programme, so we're looking in terms of Wirral Waters where the council is looking to invest and potentially provide support to Maritime Knowledge Hall, Tower Road. This is still at the sort of understanding and inception process, and these have been back a couple of times as well just to ensure that everybody's sure what we're doing. We have got the right investment, we've had the due diligence done on them, all the partners that need to be cited on this as well. And also strategic acquisitions have come to Investment Change Board, so where we're actually purchasing big investment properties, they come to the board to make sure that we can fully fund them. We've got any revenue implications, that the legal implications can be actually agreed as well in advance, and that it's tight before it actually goes anywhere. A couple of the recent ones was funding for the purchase of the properties at Newquarry, also the cinema. Wirral Culture for this year, so we're also Wirral Culture for this year, and over the past, I would say, perhaps 6 months before we became Wirral Culture, the commercial ideas in terms of the new cultural activities were coming through to Investment and Change Board, again, just to make sure that it was within our sort of right vision, if there were any commercial ideas that were coming forward, if anything needed investment for the Wirral Culture, everybody was informed of that as well. And the people, as I chair the Investment Change Board, and the people who are on Investment Change Board come from all different areas of the council. So we have somebody from finance, someone from HR, someone from legal, someone from digital, somebody from assets, someone from commercial panel, so two corporate directors on there as well. So we make sure that whichever area of the council this hits, and generally a lot of these projects will hit every area. For example, some of the cultural activities will impact on emergency planning. So for example, the giants and things like that. So make sure that everybody knows what they're doing. We meanwhile use projects as well. So we're looking now where we are purchasing properties to go forward into a growth company. So we're purchasing properties in advance that are potentially empty. And we're looking to do something with those properties and put some meanwhile use in, so people actually go in and use the properties, and whether that's creatives or some other types of people. So we're looking at how best to use those assets, they don't just sit empty, so that we can get the best use of them for the community. And also bids for capital funding. So every year we ask for capital funded bids to come forward in the capital programme. Investment and Change Board will review those bids, especially the higher bids that require specific investment. Another one is BMR, where we have Wirral Waters Investment Fund. Is implicated on Mere Park, which is maritime engineering automation. We also have some standing items, so obviously commercial ideas panels. I know that you had the commercial strategy here at Business Scrutiny, I think the last time potentially it was, or the time before. So the standing items, so the commercial ideas panel is chaired by Nikki Butterworth, who's the Assistant Director for Commercial and Commissioning. And this panel really is where anybody, any member of staff four members have actually submitted an idea to the panel, and this is to potentially generate some income, just have a look at the way that the service is operating, whether it could be more efficient, be more effective. And that panel will discuss the idea, will agree some investment. Generally, we, if there is some investment needed, we like a 12-month return in the year of the investment, so that there's no budget laid out in advance. Sometimes we can go over more than 1 year. But this, I think in terms of that panel, there's over 160 ideas come forward from staff that they're actually looking at. And all sorts of weird and wonderful ideas come forward. Some of them get knocked back because not quite right for the council going forward, or there's a lot more investment than return. But some of them are really good and really innovative ideas. And ones we've had forward recently, for example, is a tour. So we could offer a Beatles tour in the borough of where all the areas Beatles have played. Hiring some beach huts and putting them on the coast. Renting out or using the plinths on roundabouts for local artists to come and display their work there. There's one that will come forward recently which is potentially helping to alleviate fuel poverty as well. So there's all sorts of ideas that come there. And this panel will review those ideas. And they'll kind of prioritise them. They've got a priority of about 13 ideas that we're actually looking to go forward to actually implement those. Those ideas, the larger ones, the ones that require investment, will come to Investment and Change Board. And that board will agree whether actually that idea goes forward. Might need to put some resources to it, might need a specific person leading on it, might need some project management support as well from the transformation team. So these ideas come forward, and that's what's agreed at Investment and Change Board as to whether to progress the next steps. Also, the capital, the Assets and Capital Board as well. So that's a specific board that looks after our capital programme. We have updates from the Capital Board, Assets and Capital Board, and Investment and Change Board as well, which is a subgroup, just to make sure that if there's any issues in terms of capital programme, that the Investment and Change Board has got the power to kind of unblock anything that's stopping those going forward, or again, agree some investment, or agree some reprofiling or rephasing those. And also strategic acquisitions, so that we're we have a pipeline of strategic acquisitions going forward. The Investment and Change Board will ask for an update on that, where we're up to, what investment is needed, is it included in the capital programme, and to provide some support in terms of next steps. So again, whether it's something needs unblocking or whether there needs some project management support on that slide. That's mainly the slide deck that I've got, really. So that was, I just wanted to give you a bit of an insight as to what the board did and the reason for it to be set up. So if anybody's got any questions, any further questions they want to ask me on, I'm happy to answer that. There was a terms of reference circulated, but I'm not sure if they're actually in the papers. We can circulate the terms of reference, and we definitely change all the numbers. Is there a wish?
Thank you, Chair. Absolutely. Sure. And we've had a little bit here before, I'm sure it's in the beginning before. Personal, Tony Cox.
Thank you, Chair. There's quite a few points there that might have been something. I can see, because clearly there's been poor performance from the council, and that there's been a need for the investments and change boards. That's pretty clear from what you just the very short presentation you've just given us there. What I'm absolutely dumbfounded about, though, is that there's another layer of bureaucracy.